Did you know that the first general in modern Israel's fledgling army was a volunteer from America? But before we get to him, let's consider the backstory. When it comes to Israel, there's quite a backstory. Israel, after all, is the only Jewish nation on earth. Down through the centuries, there have been many Christian lands and many Muslim lands, but there is only one Jewish land, and it's pretty small at that. In fact, it's about the size of the state of New Jersey. How was it born? How did it come into being? Well, Palestine, as it was called a century ago, had been under control of the British, who took it from the Turks at the end of World War I. But the hundreds of thousands of Jews who had moved there, many having escaped the ashes of the Holocaust, desperately wanted a state of their own and were quickly running out of patience. Jewish militias formed and began targeting British policemen and other government and military installations, including airfields, forts, and Coast Guard stations. The largest militia, the Haganah, attacked the prison on the Mediterranean coast called Atlit and rescued the Jewish prisoners held there who were accused of subversive activities. The most radical of the militia groups, the Irgun, blew up a whole wing of the King David Hotel in Jerusalem, which at the time housed some of the British command. 80 were killed, including British, Arabs, and Jews. Such actions were condemned by the leadership of the Palestinian Jewish community, which favored political methods, not terrorism. When the Irgun raided the prison at Acre and freed many of their comrades, 7 of them were caught and hanged. And in return, the Irgun hanged 2 British policemen. The British were ultimately worn down by the constant pressure and eventually decided to throw up their hands, leave Palestine, and turn it over to the newly formed United Nations. The ball was now in their court, and the UN decided to take the bold move of partitioning Palestine into 2 separate states, one Jewish and one Arab. UN Resolution 181 was put to a vote on November 29, 1947. Great Britain abstained from the vote, having concluded that the proposed Jewish state would likely be eradicated quickly by Arab forces. The Soviet Union, long an enemy of Zionism, surprisingly voted yes. The United States voted yes. Jews the world over were glued to their radios as the votes were tallied. The moment it was announced that the resolution would pass, excitement turned to elation. In Jewish Palestine, there was dancing in the streets to celebrate what everyone knew was the end of the Jewish exile after 2 millennia of dispersion in remote lands. For the first time since the years 70 of the Common Era, when the Romans destroyed the Jerusalem Temple, the Jewish people had their own sovereign nation, recognized by international law. But the jubilation would be short-lived. The borders created by the resolution were a jumbled zigzag between 9 and 11 miles wide, separating Galilee in the north from Judea in the south. The city of Jerusalem, the beating heart of the Jewish people for nearly 3,000 years, was to be internationalized. Still, the Jewish communities of Palestine accepted the partition without hesitation. They knew they would have to fight for every inch of territory they would end up with. The Arab side, of course, felt different. They rejected the partition plan out of hand and made no plans to establish an Arab government. While Jews had lived comfortably in Arab lands for many centuries, an independent Jewish state was unthinkable. Even though the British were not scheduled to leave Palestine until May of 1948, the Arab side cut off Jewish West Jerusalem, which now, as of late 1947, had to endure a state of siege. Water and electricity were cut off. Each family got 1 bucket of water a day, which they used for drinking and cooking, and whatever was left provided for a single flush of the toilet. Urgently needed supplies had to be brought in from Tel Aviv on the Mediterranean coast via a winding road that snaked up the Judean hillsides. The convoys making their way up to Jerusalem were subjected to constant bombardment from the Latrun Fort held by Jordan's Arab Legion. casualties were heavy. During those pivotal days, the only weaponry in the hands of the Jewish fighters consisted of old rifles from Britain's 19th century Boer War, makeshift mortars, a dozen or so pieces of field artillery, and a couple of small planes. They had no tanks. During the siege, first aid medic Zippy Porat wrote this account. Jerusalem has been holding its breath for 2 days. A shayara, a convoy, returning from Kfar Etzion, was ambushed in the hills of Hebron by thousands of Arabs lying in wait all along the road. For 30 hours, our boys fought for their lives before the British Army made any effort to get through to liberate them. Many of my friends and fellow students were trapped in the ambush. To welcome some of them back, we had an old-fashioned shindig in my room tonight. In between mouthfuls of hot coffee, they gave us accounts of the battle, which made our skins crawl. But despite the horrible ordeal and their frustration at having had to abandon precious vehicles and arms as loot to the Arabs, they are in good spirits. That was when an American Army colonel named Mickey Marcus arrived on the scene. Having grown up as a tough Brooklyn street kid, he got into West Point and later served in World War II. In 1944, he was put in charge of clearing out the Nazi death camps. He personally witnessed the mountains of corpses and encountered the half-dead survivors of the Nazi genocide. He became convinced that the only hope for the survival of Europe's homeless Jews was a Jewish state in Palestine. He was approached in 1947 by the soon-to-be first Prime Minister of the State of Israel, David Ben-Gurion, who asked him to find an American officer who would serve as military advisor to the Haganah. Marcus himself volunteered, arriving in Tel Aviv in January 1948 and becoming Israel's first general. After leading two unsuccessful attacks on Latrun, he audaciously led the construction of an alternate road through the winding hills, bypassing the menacing fort. It was nicknamed the Burma Road, being reminiscent of the World War II supply route to China. On June 10, 1948, Mickey Marcus's Burma Road saw its first traffic heading to Jerusalem. Just a day later, a UN ceasefire went into effect. Marcus was back at Central Front headquarters, located in an abandoned monastery in Abu Ghosh, a town along the highway, a little over 6 miles west of Jerusalem. Around 4 a.m., he was walking around outside in a white blanket. An 18-year-old sentry guard challenged him, but he knew very little Hebrew and didn't reply with the designated password. The sentry fired in the air. Marcus ran toward the monastery, and the sentry and one or two others fired again, killing him. His body was returned to the United States, where he was buried at West Point with full honors. His tombstone reads, "A soldier for all humanity." Among the mourners was another great Israeli military leader and politician, known for the patch he wore over the eye he had lost in battle, Moshe Dayan. Back in Israel, controversy erupted over Marcus's death and whether his shooting was accidental or perhaps a hit job arranged by the elite fighting force of the Haganah, the Palmach, which wanted him replaced. Ben-Gurion was suspicious, but a report into the incident concluded that there had been no foul play. That report was never made public. Israel's War of Independence would continue until the end of 1948, having resulted in the staggering loss of 1% of its entire population. Armistice agreements were signed with Jordan, Lebanon, and Syria. Iraq and Saudi Arabia, whose governments had sent military units to fight in the conflict, never recognized the armistice. The fighting ended, but real peace would remain an elusive dream. Nonetheless, thanks to the sacrifice of people like Mickey Marcus, the Jews of Palestine would have their state. To this day, alongside the modern four-lane highway between Tel Aviv and Jerusalem, wreckage of armored vehicles destroyed during the siege of 1947 and 1948 can still be seen. They are preserved as a memorial to the heroes of those fateful days.